everything turn, turn, turn. There is a season, turn, turn, turn. And their time to every purpose under heaven. A time of love, a time of hate, a time of war, a time of peace, a time.
Every word they sang is actually scripture. Let me give you that passage. It is found in Ecclesiastes chapter 3, verses 1 through 8. Read it. Every word they said, every word they sang. This is Sandra Thomas, and I'm glad that you've joined me for Lily of the Valley. We're going to be talking some more about Leah. We've been talking about Leah and Rachel and the comparison. It wasn't like Patty and Kathy Duke, you know, identical cousins. They were sisters, one more beautiful than the other, one younger than the other, and there were many comparisons made. And I'm going to get into some more about Leah, especially about Leah. Rachel will be included just as a sidebar. But I want to read you another scripture to start with. This is from Song of Solomon, King Solomon, chapter 2. I am the rose of Sharon and the lily of the valleys. As the lily among thorns, so is my love among the daughters. As the apple tree among the trees of the wood, so is my beloved among the sons. I sat down under his shadow with great delight, and his fruit was sweet to my taste. He brought me to the banqueting house, and his banner over me was love. Now, of course, we do know that that is speaking to us about our own God, but it also is speaking about personal relationships between couples, between partners. To say that, let me read that one more time, that one little piece. When it says, I sat down under his shadow with great delight, and his fruit was sweet to my taste. He brought me to the banqueting house, and his banner over me was love. I sat down under his shadow with great delight. Can you say that about your partner, your husband, your wife? Can you say that? Maybe we can't some days. Other days, it might be a little bit easier. But it's important that we understand that is what we're supposed to be sharing. We're supposed to have others delight in our presence, have that person that we're married to, or we're dating or engaged to, or plan to spend the rest of our lives with, delighted to be in our shadow at the table. That doesn't mean in the shadow, like beneath or behind, but it means to be in their presence. I delight. The fruit, his fruit is sweet to my taste. Everything about him is sweet to my spirit. And he brought me to a banqueting table. He served me, not just literally, but metaphorically. He served me a banquet, and the banner over me was love. How beautiful is that? That's also God's banner over us. We can be that lily in the valley. God can make that lily in your valley. We all know that certain physical characteristics are passed from generation to generation. A physician may ask you to give him not only your personal health history, but also that of your grandparents and your parents. You know that. Did they have high blood pressure? Did they have high kidney disease and so forth? Certain physical ailments and diseases seem linked to our ancestors. The same is true for some emotional characteristics. Some families are riddled with divorce. Many, actually. Pardon me. It seems everybody on the family tree got a divorce. Some families seem to be very powerful or financially successful, generation after generation. Mm-hmm. Do you know those kind of people? I do. Other families seem to have lived on welfare for generations. Some families can point to 10 or more women in their family who've had babies out of wedlock. From generation to generation, we see rage and abuse. Even those who were abused and know how painful abuse can be have a tendency to abuse their own children, whom they claim to love. We might call these generational curses. We act out our father's sins. Jacob's family was riddled with problems. His grandmother, Sarah, had been a schemer advising Abraham, pardon me, to have a baby by Hagar and then sending Hagar away. His grandfather, Abraham, had also used some tricks, especially in trying to convince important and powerful men that Sarah was really his sister and not his wife. His mother, Rebekah, had been a schemer, advising her favorite son, Jacob, to steal both the birthright and the blessing from Jacob's twin brother Esau. Does any of this ring a bell to you? All from the very same family. Just maybe one generation back, sometimes in the very same generation. Jacob's very name, listen to the meaning of Jacob's name, means supplanter or trickster or con man. The ability to be slick was something his mother saw in him from his birth, probably because she knew what it meant to be slick herself. After Jacob had tricked his father Isaac into giving him what rightfully belonged to Esau, Rebekah sent him away to the home of her brother Laban, another trickster. Laban was slick in the family tradition. He conned Jacob into working 7 years for Rachel, then gave him Leah instead. It was a trick, a con, and out of the con, he tricked Jacob into working 7 more years. Manipulators have a need to be in control, regardless of the cost. Laban wanted labor from Jacob. That's what he wanted. He wanted to control his life, even if it meant giving up his daughters in the process. You see, he didn't value what was really valuable. The moment that Laban realized that Jacob was madly in love with Rachel, Laban knew the weakness in Jacob that he could manipulate. He controlled Jacob as a result for 14 years. Leah grew up surrounded by tricksters and manipulated by them. What is a woman to do in a situation like that, though? She must choose not to give in to the generational curse. You see, a person who manipulates others is a person who says, I need to con my way into what I don't deserve and can't earn. The way the curse is broken is to say, God is capable of using who I am and what I have. A little boy only had 5 loaves and 2 fishes, and Jesus said, "Let me have them. I can make do with them." A woman said, "I have only a little meal and a bit of oil." Elijah said, "Let me have them. That's just enough for God to make a miracle." A woman said, "I only have 1 small cruse of oil." The prophet said, "Here's what God wants you to do with it." God can take whatever it is that you have, even if it's only a little bit, and multiply it into a miracle. It can be more than enough for you to fulfill what it is that God wants you to do. A woman once worked in an office. She was a terrible typist. She kept making mistakes, and she was spending all her time correcting them. She needed her job, so she said, "I've got to do something about this." She said to herself, "I don't have all the typing skills in the world, but I am a pretty good problem solver and a pretty good artist." So she went home and began to experiment with some of her art supplies until she created the product we have come to call Whiteout. She became a millionaire, not because of what she couldn't do, but because she was willing to use what she could do, even through her mistakes. You don't need a lot of talent. You only need a little bit. Are you aware that there are models who are hired to do commercials and appear in advertisements who have only 1 good feature? It might be her hands or her legs or her feet or her eyes. She'll be hired for close-up shots of that 1 good feature, even though the rest of her may not be all that beautiful. She has found the little bit that God gave her. She's working it. Many people are in financial trouble today, not necessarily because of the recession, you see, but because they have no confidence in the little bit that God has given them. They're waiting for manna to fall from heaven instead of working with what God has already given. I have news for them. That dispensation of manna giving is over. God expects us to trust Him with what He has given us and to use what He has given us to get what it is that we need and want. Every time I meet with a group of women, I sense an abundance of treasure that God wants to release. Each one of them has something that God is eager to bless and multiply. God wants each one to recognize what He has given them, even if it's only a little bit, and start working with what they have. Quit crying over where you've been. Quit crying over your mistakes and failures. Quit crying over what you have lost. Start looking toward where you're going. Start looking toward what God has for you. Start looking for what God is going to give you as a blessing. Start looking for the way God is going to use what you have. Leah had just enough of what it was that God needed most. And so do you. You don't need to con or scheme your way into your future. Give God what you have and let Him do the miracle of fulfillment in you and for you.